Hello, welcome to our latest Virtual Bridge session, and I'm delighted to be joined by John McBain. And I keep saying the same thing, you know, I keep saying like, hello, welcome, in exactly the same tone, because I listen to all of these edits and recordings. I've got to find a different way, maybe good morning, something, not Vietnam, but something. John, you'll have to give me some ideas. Right, not to take up too much time, but today you're going to be talking about how, well, sound production at Ayrshire College has moved online and the plans for the forthcoming term. So without further ado, over to you.
Hi, thank you. Hi. Cool. Thanks very much for having me. I'm going to be working during the share screen and trying to speak at the same time. This is my third or fourth webinar, which has been completely new to me this year, but I kind of think I've got the hang of it. So what I'll do is, as I said, I'm going to share the screen and I'm going to be looking at Microsoft Sway. I'll also be opening up some interactive PDF documents, which I'm referring to as launch pads. Just kind of a disclaimer for that, when I'm using the launch pad and I'm clicking on links, if it goes to a Sway in my browser, what you'll see is the kind of back door. And because I'm in edit mode, you'll see the kind of backside of that. Whereas if you click the link in the launch pad, you would just see the front end web page. Just to kind of make that clear. Because when I'm showing this to some people, they're going, why is it in edit mode? It's just because I'm signed in. That's why. So if you don't mind, I'm going to do share screen a moment. I'll go to my desktop. I just like talking while I'm speaking because it makes me feel better about myself. And I'm going to Chrome and I'll just restart this page, reload it up and hit play. And see that's the kind of backdoor entry. So if you don't mind, can everybody see my screen okay? Just to ask that, yeah? So as I said, I'll try and flick between my screen and come back to speak face-to-face, etc. So hi, my name is John McBain. I'm a lecturer in music and performance at Ayrshire College. I'm a musician and artist, and I've worked in the creative industries, education, and offender learning and rehabilitation for the past 15 years. I've been at Ayrshire College for, I think that's over my fourth year. And in the college, we have got a great, vibrant hub of entrepreneurship and creative practice. We run quite a few initiatives alongside our mainstream courses, such as the Hello Creatives Network, High Tide PR, Sun Turtle Records, and Rockpool. Hello Creatives is a network of staff and students, professionals in our local area here to support what we do, not only in music and sound production, but across media, creative industries, hair, makeup, fashion, film, etc. High Tide PR is our in-house enterprise for promotion and public relations that our students at HNC and HND level run. Sun Turtle Records is a record label, and we release music, we sign an artist, develop them, promote them, and release them each year. And Rockpool is our brand for our live performances, our digital content, etc. Our new studios at Ayrshire College are actually called Rockpool. They were named by students because they liked the idea of it being High Tide, Sun Turtle, Rockpool, because we're based in Ayr, we're next to the beach, etc. So it's a nice little branding. So we have in our college music and sound production and school to college programs. We teach from level 5 all the way up to HND, and we have introduction courses. We've got an NPA schools to college program, access courses, HNC and HND, and we have got quite good roots into higher education, employment, and also self startup and business entrepreneurship, etc. Over the past year, we've had quite a lot of brilliant projects that we've run. We've had masterclasses from international DJs and musicians. We've had people come in to speak who are now working for the likes of Rockstar Games, who came in to do workshops with us. We have run a number of events, live events in King Tut's in Glasgow. We've also had the BBC in filming. We've also got a good partnership with Chris Boyd's charity for mental health awareness in our local area, and one of our students has actually written a single which will be released later on in the year in order to promote the charity and the kind of work that we do for mental health awareness in our area. That was just to give like a quick overview of kind of what we're about in the college, because I know that I've just came in here to speak about something. I know some people might not know like what we do at the college, so I hope that kind of gives a quick overview. I'll send this sway line point to everybody. I'm not going to hit play just now, but that's a little kind of promotional video that we use for new students and partners, etc., to show them, give them a kind of snapshot of what we do across the year. So hopefully you can have a look at that when I send it on later on to you, if that's okay. So 2020 to 20, I'm going to come back to speak face-to-face, if I can just work this Zoom. Stop screen share, that's better. So 2020 into 2021. So when the lockdown happened, we were kind of like unceremoniously told on a Friday, okay, go home. And that was it. Lift whatever equipment you need, go and hope for the best. There was no guidance available for anybody across any institution, workspace, workplace, whatever. So we were kind of like, God, we don't know what to do. But we realized very quickly, we were coming towards the end of the semester, kind of almost the end of the semester. So as I think most colleges and most education places would be. So we were kind of in the stage where, right, we've got deadlines set. We need to try our best to get students and learners to submit work and keep engaged with us. That was absolute priority. So I know this is no reinventing the wheel, and this will be a kind of similar story to everybody. But we knew we use Moodle as our main VLE, which is great, and I know the college uses that to monitor and manage engagement, etc. But we felt that we've got social media, we've got Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, email, Moodle. The communication really wasn't there, so we adopted Teams, as Microsoft were really pleased that the entire world seems to have done as well. We ported all our content, existing content, over to Teams and used the kind of layout and format, and then pushed engagement with our students through Teams and Zoom and however means necessary. I personally have quite a thing about my social media where I like to be kind of cut off from my students for various reasons, as I'm sure we'd all agree. But we felt at this exact time, in order to make sure our students felt supported and try and keep the community aspect happy, that we did kind of give a bit of leeway for it. So there were secondary accounts made up. I run our department Twitter accounts. I was like, if anybody's in Twitter, sign up. There's a means of communication, so come with us. What Teams allowed us to do was, it was almost like going back to the 90s with MSN and chat forums, etc., which I'm a 90s kid, so I was all good with that. All our students, the majority of our students are digitally natives. So the kind of adopting Teams was almost like, right, this is a new app. This is a new desktop thing. We can keep in touch, etc. And it just seemed to work. I think for some reason, because the staff in our department are quite digital and our students are very digital as well, and we push that agenda of being online for self-promotion and promotion within the industry, I think everybody managed to adopt to it pretty quickly and pretty easily. That saying, it's not a perfect platform, and it was not as easy as I'm making it sound to be, because in that strange period in March where everything was in disarray, it was a matter of, right, we had students and learners who were completely disengaged and cut off for various reasons, whether it was technology or whether it was people just thought it was like an extended, like the holidays had started. So we really, as a team, we made sure that we were, I'm not going to say hounding, but I'm going to say keeping on top of communication as much as possible. We found that the Teams app was also good for one-to-one conversations. We've got some students with mental health issues, and we needed to make sure that our priority students who we were kind of fearful of their situations or their personal circumstances were able to reach us, because in the college we have a great student support service where we work in partnership with them and students. So that, really trying to keep that, was absolute priority just for the safeguarding of our students. The phone situation in Teams is really, really was a godsend as well, because where we had students who really don't like to be online, like face-to-face like this. So instead of that, as some people are doing in here, you don't need to be have your face showing. The phone in Teams also allowed students to contact us through Teams, but without us having to give out our personal phone numbers or actually having to reach them via their phone numbers. This might sound a kind of given, but it's the online phone thing just lets you speak via the kind of online internet phone call as opposed to phone numbers. So it's actually keeping privacy and distance there while maintaining communication, if that makes sense. So that was really good for us. Porting the materials over, we realised, as I said, we were at the end of our our semester. So it was a matter of just kind of updating what we were asking our students to do. Music specifically, we had a number of like three major big performances, gigs, concerts that were already promoted that were cancelled, unfortunately. And our students were quite disheartened at the fact that all the hard work over the year was not going to happen. So instead of letting that go, what we did was we actually, we took previous rehearsal footage and for formative assessment. We took videos that they had made for evidence, for coursework, etc. And I was like, send me what you've got and we will do something with this. So we came up with this idea of Rockpool Vaults, which I'll show you in a second. And we took all the rehearsal footage, professional footage that we had, music videos, and put them together in a YouTube playlist. And then we uploaded it to a Sway document. So this was like a wall of songs, if you imagine, made up of performances, etc. And for what was a simple thing of, give me your videos and I'll do something with them, the students really bounced off that because they were like, oh, we've did these performances, these rehearsals, and they were being seen. So it's actually giving them some kind of ownership of the work that they put in, albeit the culmination didn't end with a gig. I actually ended up in a digital artifact that they can then use in their own portfolio for self-promotion, if that makes sense. What we also had was, I was kind of scared that I think it's maybe about 60, 70 music students who we were asking to do solo performances. And I was like, there's a lot of effort has been put in across the year. I don't want to let my students or learners down by saying, we're just going to go back to the assessing you on aims and what happened before. So I was like, we're going to stick to deadlines. And what I want you to do is, if you can, record yourself on your phone performing and send it to me. This might seem a kind of simple thing that everybody's used to, is taking videos on your phone, etc. But when it comes to the likes of music and assessment and education, it really is about the live performance in front of an audience. So this was actually a thing where our students, I was like, go crazy with your editing, make yourself a mini music video, imagine you're in TikTok, imagine you're on Instagram, go for it. Because what you can do is you can actually showcase yourself in the best light that you can, with lighting and makeup, your environment, whatever, go for it. And I must say, there was about 98% of our students submitted work and performances that actually exceeded my expectations of what I would get. So that was actually really, really good. I felt that was good practice. And all it was me saying, video, let's go crazy, just go for it. So yeah, it was good. I think one of the key words there was persistence for me. It was just making sure that everybody felt engaged, connected, and making sure that we were kind of pushing the notion that you're not forgotten about. We know that there's isolation issues, we know there's mental health issues. However, see your music, see your learning, see your time with us as a kind of positive, as a get out almost kind of thing. I'm going to stop ranting on there, and I'm going to go back to my screen share for a moment. So I'll go to my desktop and I'll go to share. And I'm just going to go through this little suite. I'm going to move. This is one of the things where we've been learning about how to adapt to this, is like moving and managing Zoom and screen shares and your desktop, etc. at the same time while talking is quite an art form in itself. So just to kind of summarise and move on here, I'll just read this. We all know that the challenges of on-campus classroom management, and it goes without saying that when we begin to adapt a blended model of learning and teaching and delivering online classes, there's going to be a whole host of unseen challenges that will emerge. We as educators and working in the college sector, we're going to be juggling online teaching and on-campus teaching and curating content and creating content. And it's quite challenging and quite daunting for a lot of people, staff, not even to mention students or learners, new students, returning students who have this expectation of their college life being the same, but it's not, it's going to be slightly different or totally different to people. And we need to kind of bring in tools that are going to make our lives easier, is the own word, easy. Easy is a word that I like. I don't like complicated things. The idea of the Launchpad thing that we came up with, or that I came up with, was it's not anything new, but I'd saw a couple of tutorials where it was like interactive PDF files. This is a screenshot here, and I'll open one up. And what we're actually doing is, as I said earlier, we're porting over our adapted and revised content into Moodle. And we're going to be using Moodle within Teams. Because Teams is a Microsoft software, the policies and the kind of end user licenses could change at any minute. So what we don't want is our content and coursework, etc., being taken away or disappearing if something happens in Teams at a later date. So we're going to continue using Moodle, but we're going to import things into Teams, if that makes sense. When I was teaching online, I found that when I was speaking to students and trying to get them to listen to me through Zoom, and then I'd be like, you need to go to Moodle, you need to access this document, this is where you get it. I was like, the steps that people were taking were too confusing, because for me as a learner to access maybe, for example, the student guidebook here, I would have to go away from Zoom, open up a new tab, sign in using my email, forget my password, navigate to Moodle, log into Moodle. The steps are really simple, but when you are in this environment, digital environment, there's a lot going on and it's really quite difficult and challenging. So what the Launchpad does is, I'll open one up here. This will be, for example, when we're teaching online, we'll log in, we'll send out a Zoom link, here's the time, here is a PDF, your Launchpad, and everything's going to be in that Launchpad, either for that entire course or that lesson. And what this means is, when I'm speaking to a student or delivering a piece of content, I would maybe say, right, I need you to go, you're a vocalist, and we're going to look at the syllabus for repertoire. All you need to do as the learner is open up the PDF, click on the artifact or the item here, and that will take you directly to the resource in Teams. So it's almost like an interactive PDF that just links everything that you would be asking a student to look at together. If I can go back to the PDF here, I hope that makes sense. I know that the kind of time is against us here, and I'm kind of like kind of trying to go through as much as possible. But the PDFs that we've made here are for just a kind of stepping stone or a bridge between you and the student and the learning environment to make it a bit more easy. As I said, the steps that students need to access things, ask them to go away, can become quite laborious, albeit it's really simple things we're asking them to do, like access a Twitter account or a YouTube video. But being able to send out one resource that they need and that resource takes them to places, I felt that was it'd be quite useful and quite good for maintaining and engaging online, if that makes sense to anybody. I'll show you another one here. This was not only for like teaching and learning, but for creating content. As I mentioned earlier, we're really pushing a digital portfolio aspect for our students. This is a mental health awareness campaign. This is an actual live document. So whereas we can use it to teach and deliver, we can actually use these assessment processes and procedures. For example, if a student has written in our department specifically, if our student has written a report or making a series of videos or audio, etc., and they're hosting these sources online, instead of sending us, the lecturer, a plethora of Word documents, links, etc., etc., one of these documents actually lets you include resources in it. So that is a link to a Sway document, for example. I'll just click it on design. The links are in the Sway I'll send you. So that's actually a presentation on something there. If I go back to it again, if I click here, that actually takes you to Spotify. So it's all about Spotify playlists. It's about taking resources that you have online or that we have online and linking them into a document, which we can then share to kind of make the steps a little bit easier for people to access, if that makes any sense. So I'm just looking at the chat thing there. Yes, Zoom is an art form, absolutely. I'd love to use something like this for the library resources, how-to guides. Yeah, totally, totally. This is something, as I said, that we're calling it the Launchpad because we needed some kind of sexier title rather than interactive PDF. It just sounds a bit dry. So Launchpad, it's quite Apple-centric. So it launches you into your learning, if you like, cheesy buzzwords, etc. That's the kind of way that we're going to operate in the future. When it comes to Zoom and lecturing, I did a few meetings this morning because we're developing units, etc. And we're talking about, how do you actually teach online? How are we going to engage? And we're going to kind of adopt the whole rule of email link. Here's your Launchpad. Here's your Zoom link. So Launchpad and Zoom link, turn up at this time. Log in, make sure, and instructions of, you need to have Teams open, you need to have access to your email. That's the only two tabs you need. Short introduction for the lecturer. apparently 8 to 10 minutes is the kind of good time frame for engaging people online. I know I've spoke a lot longer this morning, but 8 to 10 minutes of content, ideas, here's the kind of general aims of what I'm trying to get across. Then an activity, here's either write me 500 words, here's a short quiz, here's a video I need you to watch, here's something, some kind of task that I need you to do over the next 45 minutes. And then at the end, come back, check in with me, either a tick box feedback, I have done this, I have completed these, great, let's debrief and then let's get offline kind of thing. So it's kind of trying to kind of standardize a formula where it's easy and it flows and it's kind of a good experience for both staff and student at the same time, if that makes any sense. I'm just going to go back to the sway that I created just to see if I've missed anything at the bottom. Here it is here. So yeah, these are I can forward on. I have a step-by-step how-to guide, how to make one of these, if anybody's interested, that I can certainly forward on right now before we finish up here. So as I said, examples of the Launchpad are for content creation or curation or sending people to resources. So that was a mental health awareness one. That was another one. We like to do playlists on our Twitter account to kind of push the community engagement. Because we're music, we can share music, videos, links, etc. But that one just takes you to a Spotify playlist. That's another example of using kind of creative eye-catching artifacts, which are really simple to do in Google Slides and using various graphic design packages. I'll talk you through when we're finished kind of some of the resources I actually use to make these. This is for a promotion in the music industry unit. So this here, the unit overview, would take you to a standard unit overview. The link to, in fact, why am I showing you that there when I could actually show you an option here? This one here, this is one of the very first ones that I made. So unit overview takes you to the document in Teams or Moodle or wherever you want to send people for the kind of overview of the course. That will load up, it's there. And here as well, the class tasks is a list of tasks that I'm going to be using each week. The Twitter and the iPad, if I click that, it actually takes you to our department Twitter account. If you click on me, it will actually send you to my email address. And also the little plant here takes you to a mindfulness and breathing exercise, because we're really pushing the importance of mental health and positive mental health. So that's just another thing that we can add in, like a little extra, an Easter egg that we can throw in for our students and anybody essentially for entertainment, learning, help, resources. That one there, as stupid as this is, I'm obsessed with Funko Pop. So if you click on the Pikachu, it takes you to a dancing Pikachu video for 10 hours. So it's just to show that there is really important work-based things, but there's also a level of fun that you can have with this as well, because if we take away the fun element for learning, it just becomes quite dry and laborious. And we don't want online learning to be the same as, we need online learning to be this kind of bridge between, this is our community online, and when we meet up on campus, we have got the same kind of energy that we would have on campus as we have online, if that makes sense. So again, it's whatever kind of, I'm going to say nonsense, whatever nonsense or whatever creativity, whatever ideas you think or that I think would be engaging for students, I'm putting them in a Launchpad. That one with the Pikachu is quite stupid, but the one that's been rejigged for this, I'm actually going to be sending them to articles on promotion in the music industry. So like case studies for Sandbox, we're going to be sending them to videos and case studies from music promotion companies, PPL, PRS. We're also getting I'm getting testimonial videos and support videos made by friends of mine who work in the industry. Who I'll upload them, and then these will be kind of like little special Easter eggs, as I said, that right, this week there's a special video message from X person who will be well known to them, and that will be a kind of, wow, this is great. We had quite a few guest lectures who had to be cancelled, unfortunately, so it's been good for us to maintain that relationship in order to just enhance what we're doing as well. I'm going to go to share screen and just kind of finish off the bottom of the sway that I had developed. If you give me one second, it is right here. Nope, that's Pikachu. He can go away. So, yeah, moving forward, I think for me especially, it's communication is going to be absolutely key in how we adapt our resources and improve how we digitally interact. I think it's a given that everybody thinks they know, including myself, they think they know how to use social media, and they think, oh, Zoom will be this. But when you're actually thrown in, I don't know if anybody has run any Zoom lectures, it's quite daunting and quite intimidating to manage people looking at you on screen and knowing that, and to keep the silence away, because there's nothing worse than an awkward silence. And as somebody said earlier and agreed with me, as an art form of this kind of digital interaction. One of the things that we realised very early on was this centralised online location, having everything in the one place and making sure that resources are, for example, Word documents, PDF files, PowerPoints, links to Sway, links to resources, making sure that these are all accessible in various formats, and making sure that anything that is linked, making sure that the links are always active and not broken. There's nothing worse than when you click on a link in somewhere and it takes you to an error message. And what I was very keen when I was kind of troubleshooting things was, when things were in Teams, if I had to go and edit a document and move it into another folder, that link is then broken. So it's just ensuring that all resources are in the one place that everybody can access pretty easily. The accessibility thing is a big major step for us as well, because obviously it's becoming a legal requirement over the summer, I do believe. So ensuring that everything is there in various formats, various versions, just to make sure that no student is disadvantaged, just kind of left behind due to an accessibility issues. One of the things that I'm doing at the minute is any of our video tutorials is ensuring that there's closed captions or subtitles on the videos. And any images have like secondary descriptor text or audio descriptors, etc. The main thing, as I mentioned earlier, is the community. This is an opportunity for us here. There's a lot of kind of negatives flying about. I'm seeing it as an opportunity for us to enhance what we do and bring people together, as opposed to drive wedges. When it comes to digital learning, we've got to assume that students have access to computers, smartphones, and even the internet. That if they don't, that's a much bigger problem that I'm afraid that I can't solve. But I know that our college in specific, they are undertaking some issues to try and kind of reduce that gap of accessibility to technology, etc. But as I said, it's a way for us to kind of enhance what we're doing. And online learning, me personally, having sat in webinars, etc., I don't think it should just be, here's some resources, go and do it. That's distance learning. That's no, for the age group that I work with, that's not good enough, and that's not providing them with like a positive learning experience. And I would never ever just go, here's a resource, go away. That's no for me. I like things to be engaging and dynamic and make sure that my students are getting a good experience. And also, things should be guided by us as lecturers. One of my former lecturers once said, told me that at the end of a lesson, the lecturer should not be tired, the student should be tired. So why make things difficult? Guide people, show them the way, but don't do the work for them. Give them the platform, the launch pad to access things, guide people, talk to them, engage with them. And also, for me, it's important. This is one thing for me, was it's an opportunity for us to embrace new processes and kind of get rid of some of the stuff that was problematic and had issues, and then let's get rid of that. Let's kind of see this as an opportunity to kind of reframe what we're doing and kind of move forward and let go of some old practices and old things that just don't work, essentially. So to summarise, I think when we move into the kind of new phase of blended learning, etc., it will be challenging at first, it will be difficult, it will be a bit scary, it will be a bit problematic, but it's people like us and the network of people that you can reach out to for support, etc., that I think is very important. And we will get there in the end, hopefully. So yeah, we got this. There's my little bitmoji, as you can see, I'm a fan of this thing. I'll forward this link on actually right now to the group. I'll stop sharing the screen and come back here. In the chat, I see that there are some messages here. I'll just forward that link to the Sway I've sent it to everybody, so you can access that there. What I'll do as well at the moment is, if you give me 1 second, I will send, if any, I don't know if it's of use to anybody, but the how-to guide, I can forward that to anybody, just how to make one of these, if that would be of use. Sorry, I've lost Zoom because of that many windows open. would that be of use for how to make one of the launch pads? Is that something that anybody would like?
That'd be great, John. That'd be great.
And, sure, I'll do that right now. But that kind of does, finish off what I would like to say. I feel as if I've just waffled on for maybe half an hour, and I don't know if anything I've said is of use to anybody or it's given a snapshot or whatever. But I don't know. I'll open it up to everybody else now if there's any questions or comments or whatever.
But just for the purposes of the recording, we just have the opportunity for maybe one or two questions from the audience. If anyone has a question for John. John has a question for John, and then Joy.
Hi, John. That layout format, everything looks really engaging. What kind of proportion of your learners have you kept engaged, and is it different with your HN or your NCNQ?
Yeah, that's a really good question, actually, because for all the bells and whistles and tools that are there, Teams, Zoom, Launchpads, etc., student engagement is really, really difficult online. Our HN students at HNC and HND, I could only speak for music students because sound production is a different, well, the same department, but slightly different. Yeah. We managed to engage our level 6, 7, and 8 students quite well, and managed to get hand-ins and kept in touch with them in communication quite a lot. Our kind of slightly more introductory levels were a totally different kettle of fish altogether because some of them just disappeared off the grid completely, which was quite worrying, as I'm sure that's not just our department, that must be across the board. That was actually quite worrying. There's a message for Catherine. Catherine, thanks. We'll speak to you soon, hopefully. It was trying to keep the disengaged engaged is really, really difficult. So we did have quite a lot of students that fell off the grid, and we had to bring in our administrators and our kind of student support, student services people to try and help even reach out and get a reply, etc. So sadly, there were some that we just haven't heard from, etc. Regardless of phone calls, emails, reaching out, etc., which is quite sad to hear, actually. I don't know if that answers your question at all, but we did. It's not like a golden case study, and we managed to engage 100% students. We did have some cases and some people who just, for whatever reason it might be, we did manage to get hold of one young person who, it was internet issues, it was money issues, which meant that he couldn't get top up for his phone, so therefore there was no internet in his phone. And we were like, right, you will not be disadvantaged for your learning and qualification because of these circumstances. And that is when we were going through our assessment processes, we were looking at SQA guidelines and college guidelines and looking at aims and work up into a certain date. So, I mean, we were absolutely adamant that none of our students would be disadvantaged for learning and qualifications due to the circumstances. So,
yep. Thank you.
And Joy?
It was really just a comment. I'm the one who commented about the library because in the past we've had, we always have quite a job trying to get people to engage with our digital resources.
Yeah.
So the launchpad thing looks like a really sort of fun way to get that engagement.
I think that's it as well. We were actually, is it LRC that you're working?
Yes.
I was kind of thinking we're going to be getting our HND students to try and engage more with the resources in LRC because we actually put in an order for books, etc. And we're like, and online literature, etc. And because of the nature of what we're doing is going to be quite digitally focused and research based, I'm hoping to kind of come up with a library of resources in our LRC. So it looks exactly like that. It'll be book covers on the bookshelf.
Uh-huh.
So then send it out and go, here's this book. If you click on the book here, the one that interests you, hopefully it would take you to the link within the LRC portal to access that digitally, if that makes sense. The kind of thing for me there, or for us, or for anybody would be, it's here's the image you're clicking on, And where is that link taking you to? So that like, I don't know how the LRC portals work, but I would imagine it should need to go to, the book will be, say, within a repository, within the LRC website, a portal kind of thing. So that's something that's really, really it's really cool. And as I said, as you said, it's a kind of fun way to engage people rather than go to a website and click a white background with some text, etc. Just makes it a bit more interactive. I'm actually using this method for press releases because I have another album coming out during the summer. So I'm going to be actually using my Launchpad to promote my work, because I thought when I go back, I want to show the students that this is not just something that we're here doing for the sake of. It's like you can actually use this for your own promotion and to monetize and drive people towards your content. And I feel that I need to be doing everything. I'm not asking a student to do something that I wouldn't do myself. And also it's an option. It's not like a solution, but it's an option for you to do so.
Okay, and so just for the purposes of our recording, we've just slightly overrun our 30 minutes, but hopefully you were to stick with us, and I couldn't stop you, John. It was too good. It was literally too good to stop. But thanks for joining us online, and hopefully if you have a chance, please join us for a live session, a future live session. Until then, please stay safe. Thanks.